Hello, Neil and Buzz. This certainly has to be the most historic telephone call ever made. For every American, this has to be the proudest day of our lives.
If you go back to the dawn of the space age, they were very much the right stuff, fighter pilot jocks. The first generation were recruited out in the US Air Force.
The profile of someone who would go into space, you know, has a certain look and feel, a certain prototype to it. I mean, really up until now, if you had a disability, you know, you would have naturally assumed that space flight was not an option for you.
We believe it's time to assess the feasibility of sending astronauts with physical disabilities into space.
You know, without the force of gravity and in a totally different environment, we have an opportunity to create a new norm and an environment where really we can accommodate any type of body and there is no disabled or able-bodied body. Rather, everyone's the same.
You look back in history to seeing the difference that putting women in space made and putting people of color in space made. The same, I'm sure, will be true when we open those doors and to people with disabilities.
It's just the start, I think, and I don't know where it's going to lead.
In 1959, the first US astronauts were selected. All seven men were military personnel. But before these astronauts came the Gallent 11.
The Gallent 11 were a real important group, and I don't know if you can see this picture or not. The Gallent project was really initiated by Ashton Graybeal, who was one of the pioneers in space flight. He tested all of the early astronauts. He was especially interested in human responses to acceleration and to unusual forces.
Dr. Graybeal, who was working with NASA, chose 11 volunteers who shared a very specific characteristic. They were all deaf. Spinal meningitis had disrupted their inner ear vestibular system, also known as the labyrinth, which is devoted exclusively to the detection of acceleration. For a decade, they underwent various experiments that included living 12 days in a 20-foot rotation room and sailing in extremely rough waters during a storm in the North Atlantic.
In every single provocative situation in which he tested the labyrinthine lost subjects, there were no symptoms of motion sickness. The funny part of it is, throughout it, most of the crew and all of the people coordinating the labyrinthine lost subjects were vomiting their hearts out. As people in the trade say, they were barfing. The labyrinthine lost subjects were just sitting playing cards, having a ball.
NASA was then better able to understand how the body's sensory systems work and the effects of prolonged weightlessness and space motion sickness.
I think there's a lot of reasons why people with disabilities actually are really well suited to be astronauts. The first thing that comes to mind is that people with disabilities are used to being very nimble and to being very dynamic and responsive, to thinking quickly and problem solving, right? And so all of those are characteristics that would be highly desirable for an astronaut, right? Like having that quick response time and being able to think creatively about new solutions to problems that might develop.
While the Gallent 11 made human spaceflight possible, they've been forgotten from its history. And since then, differently abled individuals have largely been cut out of the astronaut process. Until now. Earlier this year, the European Space Agency announced that it would not only be hiring new astronauts for the first time since 2008, but it would also be running a feasibility project in the hopes of training its first disabled astronaut.
This was something we've been talking about in-house for the past 2 or 3 years. I used to call it Project X, the head of the Astronaut Center. Because we kind of asked ourselves the question, we've always had these basic minimum medical standards, but they've always called for somebody that is able-bodied in the traditional sense. But the question was, well, why? Have we asked ourselves whether we could fly somebody with a physical disability to the space station? And so alongside the call for the mainstream core astronaut corps, we've introduced this feasibility study for a para-astronaut.
Like the Gallaudet 11 program, there are very specific requirements for those taking part in the ESA's feasibility project.
In this first call, they selected different types of amputees at different levels of lower limb involvement, as well as individuals of short stature. And honestly, I think it was a really smart move because these are clearly like very well-defined disabilities, but they are primarily musculoskeletal in nature, fairly uncomplicated from a physiologic standpoint, yet there's this musculoskeletal feature that creates a visible difference and therefore categorizes them as disabled, so to speak. And, you know, for that reason, when you think about all the complexities of space flight, of being an astronaut, it's definitely like a really good starting point.
The ESA has committed an initial budget of 1 million euros and will be working with two or three selected applicants on what technical adaptations existing spacecrafts and stations may need.
For example, for the launch vehicle, for the crew capsule that gets them up to the space station. We, the Europeans, don't have our own vehicle, so that means we're going to have to work with the US providers. There's Boeing and there's SpaceX who send astronauts up to the space station. So we're going to have to work technically with them. They're going to have to also train to be a regular astronaut, because what's important for us is this is not kind of a joyride. We want them to be able to participate in a meaningful mission aboard the International Space Station, to undertake maintenance tasks, to run scientific experiments, and so on.
You know, in the disability community, we use this phrase called universal design. And I think what the para-astronaut program is pushing us to think about is, again, designing our environments so that they're more universal and suited for everybody and every type of ability level, you know, from day one without having to retrofit it later down the road. So I think that thinking about universal design as it relates to settlements and other planets or space in general helps us to really reframe that and to think about, you know, whether you're an infant or someone who's 100 years old, whether you're large or small, whether you have a visible disability or not, you know, what type of environment can we envision that reduces the barriers for everyone to the greatest extent possible?
Some of the adaptive support systems these individuals use on a daily basis may no longer be needed in space, an environment that could level the playing field for many who are considered disabled on Earth.
When you look at the International Space Station, everybody floats up there. Your use of your feet in space isn't really needed. And in fact, astronauts come back with very soft feet because they haven't been used for all that time. So the adaptations on the space station, they will be considered, but I imagine them to be not massively challenging because of the environment that you are in.
Once you're in zero-G environment, the legs are not tremendously useful. Of course, the astronauts spend a lot of time doing physical exercise to maintain their health so that when they come back to Earth, they're in a good state, because if you don't do so, you lose muscle mass and you also lose bone mass.
Astronauts can lose as much as 10% of bone density during 6 months in space. To offset the effect, they exercise for 2 hours a day, at least 6 days a week.
They do an hour of cardio, perhaps running on a treadmill, exercising on a bicycle, and they do an hour of what you and I might refer to as weightlifting. Now, in space, you can't lift weights. Nothing has a weight because you don't feel gravity. But we use sort of hydraulic springs, like resistance to tension those muscles and so on.
Maintaining bone and muscle mass will be critical for para-astronauts. But as humans venture further from Earth, more room on rockets and space stations is needed for fuel, so space is at a premium. One innovation that could let exercise take up less space and time is the high-frequency impulse for microgravity, or HiFiM. HiFiM promises to reduce the astronauts' current workouts to just 6 minutes a day on one machine.
Excellent.
It does this by enabling astronauts to jump in zero gravity.
And relax.
So to be able to jump is a fantastic way to load the skeletal system, build up muscle density, and also cardiovascularly, it's ferocious on the body. Through ESA bed rest studies, we've proven that jumping will mitigate bone density and muscle mass loss with just 50 jumps a day. That's 4 to 6 minutes a day. And that's amazing. The time that's going to give astronauts back to do experiments and more science in space. But you can't just jump, because you've got to make sure the load and vibration does not go through the spacecraft. So HiFiM is designed to absorb its own load and vibration when an individual is jumping.
HiFiM has been developed with both astronauts and para-astronauts in mind. Former Royal Marine Lee Spencer has been trialling the machine throughout its prototype phase.
My left leg was really badly damaged when I lost my right leg. And that really means that I can't actually sprint or jump. But the great thing that this does is it allows you as an amputee to train in a way that I've not been able to train before, and that's with explosive muscle movements where you can jump again.
We can actually control the load that's going through his prosthetic and then into his limb. So we can develop the bone density and muscle mass through that limb, through both limbs, through his pelvis, through his spine, but also condition the point where the stump of his leg meets the prosthetic, and we can condition and develop that and make it stronger and more use to getting that load passed through it.
Although it's not yet part of the feasibility project, the UK Space Agency has been supporting the development of the HiFiM. Later this year, it'll be tested in microgravity on a parabolic flight, where Lee will become the first disabled person to jump in zero gravity.
We in society tend to define someone by their disability. I thought I had to redefine who I was within the parameters of disability, and I was wrong to do that. And in no other walk of life is someone defined by something they're not good at or something they can't do. But if you have a disability, then that can tend to define who you are, certainly from other people's point of view.
You know, if you look at the definition of disability by the World Health Organization, where we've really moved globally is an understanding that disability is a combination of both an individual's impairment, but then also how that interacts with the environment. And so you can have a specific impairment, take the amputee for example, but if that individual is then working and living within an environment that is fully accessible, then the disability, so to speak, really melts away, right? And so disability is really defined by our environment. And you know, that's why all of this work around the para-astronauts and thinking about adapting space is really so innovative and exciting, because I think we have an opportunity to really totally redefine what is a, so to speak, normal body and what needs to be adapted.
If the feasibility project is successful, the European Space Agency will be looking to include the para-astronauts in future missions, including a trip to the International Space Station by 2025. But beyond making space more accessible, the ESA is also hoping a diverse crew will give them an even greater chance of success in future missions.
We know that diverse teams are better teams. We know that people that don't all have the same life experience and don't have all think in the same way, come from different countries, work better together. It's the fantastic thing about working in the European Space Agency. We're 22 different countries working together. And those different cultural backgrounds and ways of thinking make us strong. And the same is true if you've got a crew trying to go to Mars for the first time. You want a mix of people, different genders, different backgrounds, different countries, to make a stronger team.
The space industry is known for its innovation, and the research and findings from the feasibility program might not only produce the first para-astronaut, but also have an impact on how disability and adaptation are treated back here on Earth.
A lot of the adaptive technology that we use here in the US you know, the speed of research and development, the speed of innovation, sometimes can be a little bit stagnant. And so I think that reframing that and thinking about, well, how do you best empower people with disabilities in a space environment? How do you best empower people to be astronauts? Has the ability to translate to really push us a lot more quickly in our innovation here.